I think you got muted. Chris, mute.
Okay.
Just the last 30 seconds or so, 25 seconds of you talking.
Hi, everybody. Today I was going to do the historical slideshow that I've done with the other pieces, but the feedback that I've gotten is they want to go more into the music. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to like super speed through the slideshow, and I'm going to give you the slide link so you can read all the speaker notes and sort of digest it on your own time. And then as well as the resource list. So I'm really expecting people to sort of read a little bit more in terms of the historical context. Of course, I'll share more pertinent information that directly relates to interpretation and in performing with you today. And in talking with Tim today a little bit before this session, rather than sort of do a surface dive for the first three movements, we're going to do a deep dive into the first movement. So we'll kind of focus on the first movement. And by the way, I have to come to a decision pretty soon about whether we're going to perform all three movements. And I think it all kind of depends on what the preparation level is and how people are feeling in terms of doing all three movements. I would love to do all three movements, but we may have to make a decision because I'm just seeing just the stress level of everybody at being super high. So I think there's a little bit of miscalculation on my part in calculating how much music we can actually learn. Because remember, although we are starting at a point, and in fact, we're starting a little bit later than our usual concert block, our first concert block would have given us a first concert of the semester probably in the first week of March, right? So we would have been much more into the piece at this point in a normal semester. But even with a deficit of that, we're going to be facing the fact that each period, concert rehearsal period, we're not going to have 2 hours each day on Tuesday, on Thursday. I mean, I'm talking too much, but basically we only have two half-hour slots separated by a half-hour slot. And I'm really hoping to use that 30-minute break in between to kind of talk about things that arose in rehearsal, but also talk about historical context and things like that. And maybe we can sit out in the lawn where there's nice and actually talk about Mahler and Copland. And I'm really looking forward to doing that. But in terms of the Mahler, I may at one point decide maybe our level would be higher if we just do two out of the three movements. All right, so, but I won't make that decision now, okay? But for today, we're focusing on the first movement. All right, so I'm gonna share the screen with you and I'll go through the slides of the historical context. And I'll do it really fast because I don't want to spend so much time on the historical context. Just to let you know, though, his fourth symphony comes at a point in Mahler's creative output where he is really struggling to come to terms with the fact that he's faced with being the new music director of the Vienna Opera House. And when he takes over, the opera house is really in not good shape. And he really wants to make it the best in the world, but that means fighting a lot of institutional backward-looking mess of the Vienna Opera House, including the fact that the press and many of the intrigue that is happening around the opera house is really attacking Mahler, not just on musical terms, but the fact that he was Jewish. So the anti-Semitism in Vienna was pretty terrible at this time. So the press was really mocking Mahler in terms of his, not just his musical work, but his work as a music director, how his sort of CEO style and all of that. Long story short, this period and then his first three symphonies didn't really have critical success. And looking back now at Titan and Resurrection and the Third Symphony, we think, wow, those masterpieces, but at the time, he wasn't really received as the giant that he is now. And for a long time, if it wasn't for the championship of people like Mandelberg and Bernstein, we might not know his music at all. These are pictures of his composing hut that he found and built. And so he had this cycle of working not only as a music director of the Vienna Opera House, but music director of the New York Philharmonic. And so during the year, when the season is in full swing, he really wasn't able to write music at all. So most of his compositional output happened in the summertime, actually in that hut, that orange covered, and that's his piano right there. So there's a funny story about this piece called Revelge, but it's about constipation and laxatives, but I'll read about that later. And then once that piece, it was sort of the piece that broke the dam, so to speak, creatively. And he basically wrote Symphony Number 4 in 10-day period. But he was actually terrified of not having enough time to write down this sort of piece that he heard and envisioned. And then he had to kind of put off finishing the piece until next summer. And he was really afraid that he would forget most of it. It's really, until this point, his output, he's really known as sort of this big, huge orchestra sound person. But he used the orchestra and musical materials in a very different way than he did in the first, second, and third symphony. No trombones. It's a large orchestra, but instruments are used for color, and they're never all used at once. 56 minutes is sort of a subcompact of a piece. So, the third symphony is 92 minutes, and the Resurrection Symphony, if it's depending on the tempo you take, it could be as fast as 75 minutes or as slow as 96 minutes. And and he actually had movement titles that he considered, but like the other symphonies, but he ended up not using any of them because he didn't want the public to have a different idea about the piece. I'm just going to play this video because anyway, this German word some of you are a German speaker, but I had a heck of a time pronouncing these German terms, especially this one. But this very first figure, he describes it as being, it should be like a Viennese waltz so that we really, really linger. So at this point, I'm going to, let me just speed through the presentation. So connection to Schubert, and we'll go into this recording later. Schubert and Mahler. So it's only 1 minute, so watch this video later, and then we'll talk about the different movements. All right, so now what I'll do is, I kind of did this slide that should have taken an hour in about 9 minutes, okay? So please observe the slide on your own time. So now I'm going to share a screen with you. So on the screen, you'll watch the score of the first movement. And we are doing the Klaus Simon reduction of the piece, not the original Gustav Mahler, obviously, because of social distancing. There are many different versions, many different reductions as well. Mahler himself had three different editions. The one by Universal, published in 1911, is the one that most orchestras play. But there is the smallest reduction is actually by Erwin Stein, which only has parts for violin, one violin, one cello, flute, clarinet, two pianists, harmonium, one percussion. That's it. Okay, so that's the smallest version. Right. The version we're doing by Klaus Simon actually has a full woodwind quintet, strings. It could be played as small as string quintet or double done parts. A pianist playing one part on piano and one part on harmonium, two percussionists. So it's a little bit bigger in reduction of the Mahler. There's also a conductor in Queens, Jay Young Lee, who have done a very, very interesting reduction for chamber orchestra of double winds. So it's a sort of double winds, two horns, two trumpets, and string section and whatnot. So it's kind of the smallest version of Mahler you could do. But of course, originally Molly had quadruple wins without trombones. Okay, so now I'm going to share the screen with you. We'll see the score. And what I'll do is I'll play some excerpts from this Mangelberg recording. No, not there, that one. Wait, hang on. How do we, I just had this working. I think I have to get out of that screen. Yeah, there we go. Okay. All right. So I've queued up the Mangelberg recording. Hang on. Sorry about the technical difficulties. I had originally intended to do a broadcast on my iPad, but I'm in my office now and the Wi-Fi setting is different. So my iPad and this computer is different. So anyway, you don't need to hear about it. So the Mangelberg recording that I'm going to share with you, and I'll put in the link as well. Mangelberg is considered one of the most closest interpreters for Mahler. They knew each other. Mangelberg is known to attend Mahler's performances of his music. And what's shocking about this particular recording, and we'll play a few examples from the recording, where he really takes the advice of taking liberties and making contrasts really, really wide, right? So this very first example of this Viennese let's go to the recording. Okay. To start the recording and then share it. So, I mean, to me, when I first heard that that those three notes pick up that we're here twice, it was so shocking to me that Mangelberg would take that much time. I mean, it does say poco ritardando on the piece, it doesn't say molto ritardando, but I think, and he doesn't do it every time it comes back, but those first two times, he really takes time on those three notes because Mahler has is quoted as describing those this particular melody as being a particularly Viennese style way of delaying. So he wants to take time on those. So one of the things we have to look at is how do we decipher what is Mahler's intention and what's clearly on the score and what is tradition that have been laid on top of the piece as the piece has gotten to us. So most of the time, when you go find a Mahler recording on YouTube, you're not gonna find a Mangelberg type interpretation. It's gonna be much more, much less time on this. There tends to be a, and this is sort of symptomatic of standardization of music in different places. So it used to be you would go hear an orchestra in Prague where Vladislav is from, and you would hear a particular very dark reedy oboe double reed sound, where and it was unique to the Czech Republic. You would go to Berlin, and Berlin would have a different sound, and Berlin would have this sort of more robust, physical, a massive character, whereas the Viennese orchestra would have a much leaner, more transparent color. And you could sort of make the argument that French orchestras used to play with much more translucency and transparency. But as the American orchestra sort of became standardized because of the audition process, what started to happen is not only did each orchestra in the world get to know the music through recordings. So there was this a level of technical perfection people expected from recordings. So if you listen to the Mandelbrot recording and continue to listen, the oboe sounds terrible, okay? So it'll be sort of the thing where an orchestra would say, well, our section sounds better than that. And then it sort of became a Cold War type of built up where they would go into a recording session and they would sort of not come out until they had perfection. So the effect of the recordings, it basically made, on one hand, on the positive side, orchestras better in terms of the general standard bar at which they played. But the negative aspect of that was it started to make every orchestra sound alike and similar to each other. And in fact, even in America, if you went and went back 75 years and you heard the Philadelphia Orchestra, they had a distinctive sound. If you went to listen to the Cleveland Orchestra, they had a distinctive sound. I'm not sure you could say that anymore with any particular American orchestra, because they've become so technically proficient. It's sort of like a group of superhuman beings who are able to play completely into it, completely in any style you want. So, and Esa-Pekka Salonen, as it took up the mantles of the LA Philharmonic, he wanted the orchestra to sound like the composer that they were playing. So not rather than a regional national orchestra that had a particular distinctive color as an orchestra. So on one hand, you could say this is, and I'm getting a little bit too much into the weeds of this, but it matters in interpretation and performing of Mahler. On one hand, the uptick in the technical prowess of an orchestra, it sounds better. But on the other hand, you lose the distinctive color of that nationalistic or regionalistic orchestral sound, right? Oh, there's the Philadelphia string sound, the Stokowski sound. However, imagine if you're a composer and you want the orchestra to play your piece, but in fact, you're asking for a different sound than the Stokowski string sound, right? So in terms of the metrics that the orchestras used to have, is they had their own sound with which they played Brahms, Bach, Mozart, Beethoven, Dvorak in the same color, no matter who the composer was. So on one hand, there was this great advantage of orchestra sounding like really characteristic. Wow, that's Philadelphia. Wow, that's the Czech National Orchestra. Wow, that's Berlin, that's Vienna. So there was a sense of being able to hear the regional differences of orchestras. And one of the things that really changed my life was I was in Prague and I heard the Czech National Philharmonic play Dvorak. And I was like, I have come to the right place to hear Dvorak. Okay. And I felt the same way when I heard the Vienna Philharmonic play Bruckner and things like that. But there was also a flip side of that was I once heard a Vienna Philharmonic play Gershwin and it sounded, it doesn't sound right. So what do we do as musicians? As an oboist, Tim can talk about what an oboist of a particular lineage of teacher should sound like, right? So I'm sort of John Delancey lineage because Ray Still studied with John Delancey. So my oboe playing has that sort of sound. If I was a John Mack lineage, I would have a much more robust, darker sound, whereas the John Delancey, Ray Still sound is much more transparent, much more French. Okay. So the advantage of that versus the advantage of really trying to decide who is the composer and how do I make this composer sound like the composer rather than a particular orchestra from a particular time or a particular region, right? And so just as a fun exercise, go find a Berlin Philharmonic recordings from the 60s, the Jan Karajan, and he sounds more authentic with each composer because it becomes more about realizing the intention of the composer. But you fast forward 20 years when he's became an egomaniac and he's gained all kinds of power and he has complete control of the Berlin Philharmonic, how they sit, who is hired and fired. In the recordings made from 70s and 80s on, they have this sheen. They sound so, it's a very distinctive Berlin Philharmonic sound. But the problem is whether they're playing Tchaikovsky or Bach or Beethoven, it sounds the same. It's the same sort of this wonderful color, but the distinctiveness of the composers are no longer as present. Tim, you had a question?
No, I was just saying you can actually kind of hear that if you listen, if you know, while you get access to the digital concert hall. So if you listen to the recordings over the years, you can hear how Karajan's conducting style and the sound actually changes. Just comparing, you know, to the
yeah, I had a conducting teacher who'd say, Karajan recordings before 65, great. After 65, pff, throw them out. I mean, I don't know if I would completely agree with that, but because I think there are cases. Anyway, generalization is no good. Okay, coming back to Mahler. So when you're faced with a passage like in this very opening passage, where you have to decide how much time am I going to take in this, de-da-da, and then also, just look at the directions in just this measure three. Okay, the sleigh bells, right? And then what used to be, so in the piano part, right? These two folks have running eighth notes and it says one writ, no ritardando. Okay, all right. So they're charged with a task of keeping the tempo. And his directions could not be clear without ritardando. Okay. Then you look at, let's look at the violin last. Flute also has this eighth notes of the eighth note rhythm without ritardando, one writ, right? But then clarinet has ritardando poco. All right. Okay. So you're sitting, the flutist and the clarinetist are right next to each other. Okay. All right. And they have to decide, okay, you're not slowing down, I'm slowing down. What do I do? And then on top of that, you have this strange on poco ritardando, grazioso. Tim?
I just wanted to comment, I found it interesting. I have the original score open while you're doing that. And okay, the bells actually don't have a on ritardando in the original score.
Okay, so I also have the, let's go to the, hang on, let me open the original score. Where do I go? There we go. All right. So in the original score, this is a 1911 universal version. Yeah, too much. Sorry, I went too happy-go-lucky. I'm going to make it a little bigger. So, flutes who have the eighth notes has one writ, clarinets poco writ. You're right. Schnell, the bells part doesn't have that one writ sign, right? And then if I go on down further, let's make it a little bigger. Etwas rückhaltend, grazioso on this eighth notes. So there is a, so, okay, if you take, let's say we take the bells out of the equation, but you can't really take that out of the equation because in fact, that's really, the bells are doing the flute rhythm, right? You can't really say the flute rhythm and the bell rhythm are separate because so yes, you're correct. The one writ isn't there in the bell part, but I think it's, no one really could make the argument that those are two different material. Whereas the clarinet poco writ and the violin eighth note pickup are different materials, right? So I have this bar, I've seen conductors come to almost a fist fight in terms of talking about no. So I have conductors who said, everybody could slow down. And then some said, whoa, you can't make that decision because it says on a writ in the eighth notes. So in the first three bars, there's this problem, right? Because it is unclear, or people are saying it's unclear. I actually think it's really clear what Mahler wanted. I actually think he wants both time zones, one that is not slowing down and one that is slowing down. Okay. Just stay with me for 1 second. Now, the clarinet line, so left, that one is poco writ, right? And the violin line has not just poco writ, but it actually has directions in two languages, Italian and German. And I think that's significant. Grazioso, Italian, etwas rückhaltend, German. So I think, plus the fact that, and these fingerings are Mahler's fingerings. So he wants four going to two, this F sharp going to two, to G. So the solution that I go to all the time is, you know what? Let's try what the composer wrote down first before we try anything else, okay? So let's try having the eighth notes maintain the tempo, clarinet slow down a little bit, and then violin slow down a lot more, right? And then we all begin the next bar together. Right. So one of the homework I'll ask you to do, I want you to go out and see what people do, because it's stunning what people do. Some people will just ignore this Rückhaltung altogether. Some people will line up the clarinet and the violin to be at least they're coordinated, right? And then some people will actually try to have three time zones, eighth notes that are constant, chop, 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 da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And that's really actually hard to do. The more specific I get as a conductor, the less room you have to actually do this passage. Okay. All right. Another place. I'm going to skip a little bit. One of the things that is really important, and this is a really good tip that somebody gave me before. Let me share the screen again. So on the resource link, Tim found one, I found one in terms of the German glossaries. You should really know what they mean, right? But sometimes when you're playing in performance or in rehearsal, when you see this German tempo, right? Your brain does a little freeze, right? So sometimes I do a little shorthand, right? So if I see something like this, I might do something like that to indicate, okay, now the tempo is gonna go forward, okay? But if I see something like the previous bar where un poco rit or grazioso, then I might do something like either like, oh, come on. I might do something like that, or actually do the arrow this way to indicate the tempo is slowing down. All right, it might be a good shorthand for you to do. So once you go through the German terms and translate what the tempos are wanting, okay? All right, I'll clear the format. Sorry. Okay. There's another place. Let's go to measure 37. Sorry, I overshot it. Okay, so you'll have this flurry of activity and then a new section tempo, okay? So I'll play that recording. I'll find minute 37, minute 39, okay. Can you hear? Okay. You guys hear?
Yeah, we can hear it, yep, but the whole screen is blacked out.
Okay, got it. All right, I'll go back to the. When you look at those dashes, you know, it's no longer, so Mangelberg is not really treating those as articulation, but he's actually using that as a temporal signature. So whenever there is these figures, and leading into this big ritardando bar at 51. So before that, when this cello solo section starts after the flurry of activities, and then he takes quite a bit of time adding like maybe two beats or so in that tempo, right? And then all these tenutos are treated as taking separation and separating more time. And all he's going by is bright gazungun and tone. So, of course, there's a nicked island, just don't rush. And then, but every time these figures, and also, all of these tenutos, he takes more time. He takes time here. So he's really using the tenutos as a way to give more time to the music so that you can actually stretch out the phrase. So one of the things that that we tend to think about, and we live in the age of the techno beat where the beat, it's about being in pulse, right? But that's not how the music making was done in this era, where it was about taking time, it was about taking making a musical phrase clear by separating structures, right? So we think about being in time as the most important thing in playing in an orchestra. But I think we have to think more about what are the phrase structures? How do we take time at the end of phrases? So you have to use things like the tenutos and how Mahler wants us to use the tenutos to take more time. So really think about the tenutos when you encounter them, whether it needs more time, and how much time is needed. So not only looking at the German, but really looking at the articulation markings, we have to think about how much time we're adding to each section. Okay, let me jump to another section, measure 148. I mean, at the end of this section, 50, here. Actually, this is worth hearing. So I'll play the music again. Thank you. Right, Obex really sounds terrible, but go on. And look at this 2-4 bar coming up. Hang on. Where did that come from? Like, dee-da-dum, bum, bum, dum. That's the tempo, right? One and two and ya-pa-pi-pa-pa-pi-pa-pa. I mean, there was no indication whatsoever that that should speed up, right? In the music, Mahler would say, no, but it's fast notes. So you go a little faster. So that one, I'm not so sure about. We've heard Abel Pereira, the horn player, when he was giving the masterclass, Adam was playing this figure. Dim, da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. He wanted that contrast to be higher. So even he thought different music should have different pulsation, different tempo. So yada dim bum bum di ba da bum. This has sort of one type of tempo and pulse and feeling, and it feels like a different music than da da di da da di da. It's different dynamic. So I think whenever you have a contrast of dynamic, contrast of musical ideas, the tempo should change as well, right? In terms of how much degree, that might be debatable. But these two musical passages certainly should not be the same tempo, right? So in some ways, we're trying to maximize the character differences, right? And remember when Abel was talking about highlighting have more fantasy, right? It's about a child's world, so that each musical character emotion that you're depicting and displaying really feels like a different animation character, right? So maybe this oboe music is one person, and then the when the violin joins in, it's a little bit different, but the same sort of family of animals, right? But then maybe when the 16th note comes in on the 62, maybe that's a bigger, furrier, faster animal. Okay, all right. And then I'll skip over to measure. I lost my place. Oh, 76. Now the eighth notes come back here at 72. So let's go back to the recording. Island is forward. Okay, so right there, here, this tempo we went wieder gemalkelt. So I mean, that's getting back to the previous tempo, but which one, right? Is it when the oboe starts that music? But it's getting back towards that bum, 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 right? And there's no indication that all of a sudden this is faster, right? In fact, this particular recording started with a weird tempo rather than starting at, like most modern orchestras, yum, bum, 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 bum. It actually started bum, 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 a little bit slowish, and then as if it was kind of waking up to get going, right? So one could make the argument that Mangelberg was actually looking over at 72 to look at how to start measure one. So rather than start measure one at a constant tempo, yum, bum, 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 he's looking at 72. Well, there I have to get back to tempo. And so that's what I'm going to do in the beginning to be a precursor to what happens at 72. Okay. But the problem is that is his interpretation. There's nothing in the music that Mahler indicated that actually he wants a wind up of tempo. Okay. Just as to remind us, the original tempo, didactic, Nicht Island, right? It's kind of an open tempo. It is not a very specific, there's no number, there's no metronome marking. It just says, don't be in a rush, don't worry, right? So Whenever we have deciding on something, you have to be in data gathering mode for a while. You can't make a decision based on what you see on the first bar, because first bar has implications and how you play the first bar based on every other time that musical material occurs throughout the piece. So you have to think about 72, you have to think about later in the piece when you have that same jump, 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 jump material. So, because that is how structure is set. Okay, so let's go back to 72. Oh, I went too far, sorry. So the eighth note figure comes back. Now here, there is a different dynamic marking in the eighth note figure. It goes dim to triple P. Clarinet has the same rit poco a poco, and the violin has, now it's missing the Italian and German, right? Now it's unified in terms of not only the placement of the rit poco, right? So to me, when I'm looking at this, I would do less here, less slowing down of the eighth notes in the violin part. Let's see what Mandelbrot does, because it's kind of infuriating. All right, hang on. I think he actually does a lot more than the first time. I think I would have went the other way, but that's the option he chose. I mean, if I was a clarinetist, I would be like, I have the faster notes, please. Okay. Now, tempo one, which tempo one? Is it of bar four? Right. So whenever you encounter tempo one after a rallentando, then you have to always look back to which tempo one are we going back to? When it was earlier in history, it made it easier. Tempo one meant you just do the same tempo as the beginning. Okay. But tempo one of bar four. Out tempo. So same music, right? So it's pretty clear bar four is equivalent to after 72. Right. Sorry. I should have made a tap. Sorry, now I'm lost. Where are we? Here. Right. Okay. And then we're going to go further on. At 91, there's an interesting choice to make. So from this point on, Mandelbrot is pretty standard. He doesn't make too many crazy, unusual interpretations. But at 91, now, let's see what he does with that tempo marking. So, I mean, wieder sehr ruhig und etwas zurückhaltend. So that's definitely much slower. All right, so let's see what Mandelbrot does. Wow, he's really stretching those pseudo eighth notes in his son. I mean, he is really stretching out that Ruta Noto, right? So in some ways, because he took so much time on these those opening three eighth notes, here when you have a morendo, ritenuto, triple P, breath marks, then you kind of have to make a much bigger slowing down just because the structure that you set up is much bigger, right? So the cost of going so slow in that first three note pickup, you're going to have to pay for that at the end. And I think to me, as with my modern 2021 sensibility, it's just way too much, right? So, but maybe that's just because of years of listening to Abbado and do take the middle of the road approach and very, to me, tasteful interpretive choices. So here, but the important things to consider here in the Ritenuto section 99 on is the tenuto markings. So it's not just, it's, I would have, if I didn't hear the tenutos, probably would have placed the emphasis on the D. Rather than the C, C natural. But here he's really wanting the emphasis to be on this C, that C, that C. D. D. Okay. Questions before I go to another segment. So there are things when we need to consider interpretive choices, right? That's what I'm trying to really get at in terms of giving us tools to be able to determine how do we determine how much to slow down, how much not to slow down, right? You could say, okay, well, Mangalbov knew Mahler and he must have heard his performances, so that must be true. I think that's not scientific enough and maybe not true to understanding the piece. I think you have to dig a little deeper into the score and see actually what it says. Barenboim, I heard him once say to a group of young conductors, if you don't make a choice, then you're not doing your job as a musician, right? So you have to look at the material and you have to make a musical decision that's based on what is written in the score. So I think listening to recordings is great, but you have to actually look deeper into the score and try to figure out what really Mahler is trying to have to indicate through his writing, right? So I think for me, when we have that, the return of the opening bars right here, which was 72-ish right here, right? So here, I find particularly helpful in information when basically same music is notated differently. So the fact that there's lack of Italian or lack of German on this violin figure, right? So to me, that is definitely less than the first time, right? To me, when the dynamic of the eighth notes in the bells and the eighth notes, it does a diminuendo. To me here, it should be unified in terms of, because it's the same diminuendo that's happening in the Ritardando Poco, right? So to me here, there shouldn't be a temporal sort of different time zones where one music is in a different time and different rate of going, and another music, the 16th notes and the violin music is slowing down, right? So to me, this is the same music as the beginning, but very different in how it should feel to the audience. So you have to be looking kind of back and forth whenever a section is repeating or the music is very similar, and notice the differences to be able to gauge how much you can slow down, how much you can speed up, and whether your conjecture the first time of having two different time zones was correct. I'm not sure if my conjecture that the first time there are two different time zones is correct. All I know is that it's a really strange place. Okay, going on. Next place I want to show is 116. So we've gone to this end of this whole section. Music starts again. All right, here. Now, it's pretty much the same three eighth note pickup that we've been talking about as the beginning, the fourth bar into the fourth bar. All right, now let's see what he does. But look, before actually we look at what he does, let's make some predictions, okay? All right. Now, what I think is really important here is, there are two different kinds of music, right? The 16th note and eighth note and the three eighth note Viennese pickup, right? Da-da-da-pia-da-pa, right? However, there's an important, very important differentiation here, which is what? Anybody know?
I forget like what the
fingering. It looks like the fingering and the down bow might be different.
Yeah, the fingering is different. I know the fingering, but it's different, fingering's place, different notes. So it's that's not really that important. What's okay. important is the sempre a tempo, because that wasn't there before. Yeah. Right. And even the there's a diminuendo in some of the parts of the eighth notes. Yum bum 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 bum. Right. However, fortissimo sempre in the 16th note figure, right? There's no diminuendo there, right? So I think that idea of the 16th note becoming a diminuendo, right? That was indicative of everything slowing down together, right? But here, not only does he put sempre a tempo, but fortissimo sempre in some of the parts. All right, so let's see what Mandelbrot does. How about that, right? So even Mandelbrot says, okay, I mean, Mahler put sempre a tempo, so I better keep it moving. He does slow down just tiny bit though, right? He does, there's a tiny bit. Let's listen to it again. But it's more of a, it's not a full stop. It's more of a, yum, bum, bim, ba, di, dum, pia, dum, ba. Right? Definitely not T-I-E-P-I-A-D-A, not one of those, right? So I would really urge all of us to really look at what Mahler has written, right? Because this is why this is important. Mahler was so engulfed in being the music director of the Vienna Philharmonic and the conductor of the New York Philharmonic, plus all the guest conducting he must have done, during the year, during the season, running from September to May or June. Summer was his time to write and compose, right? So he had this sort of three-year pause in his output because various reasons. And then all of a sudden he had a flood of productivity in the summer of 1899, where he wrote the Fourth Symphony in 10 days. And then he couldn't touch it because he was so busy. And the next summer, he came back, finished the first draft. But the way he worked was, it always worked in this these phases. Once he's finished, he would take that to the orchestra and then rehearse it and read it with the musicians and tinker and workshop it. And then he would come back and then write in all the German directions. And there's a perfect example of this, where in the Second Symphony, the first movement exists as a separate tone poem called Totenfeier. And if you look at the score of Totenfeier, it's basically exactly note for note, first movement of the Second Symphony. But the difference is it has none of the German directions and about 50% of the dynamics. Now, once Mahler had a chance to read it through with an orchestra, workshop it, the next summer he comes back, he adds all kinds of German direction. And sometimes these German directions are not just one or two word, or it says note for a conductor, and it goes on for a paragraph of German, right? And it's basically his way of making sure the performers or the conductor knew what he wanted out of the music, right? So you have to really pay attention when you start to see a lot of German on top of the music, okay? So when you see something like sempre tempo, and this is in bold, that means universal edition, look at the manuscript and realize sempre a tempo is in boldface. So they made it a boldface type, okay? All right, okay, let's go to, I'm just gonna skip a whole bunch. Let's go to 270. Where are you? Here we go. Oh. Okay. So basically we've seen this before, okay? So before I play it, pay attention to the tunita markings. Schalltrita auf means it bells up for the winds, right? Okay, all right. Let's go to the video and I'm gonna skip to 1220. Okay, so basically we've heard that before, it was done before. And I think most of the directions in terms of articulation is very similar. It's just now orchestrated fully out, right? And so whenever you have music that repeats, even if it repeats exactly the same, you shouldn't do exactly the same. Here, you have to allow room for more tone because the look at the German he's using. Bog Wechseln, lots of bow, right? Gross, stick, like lots of bow, right? Zeitlassen, take more time. Mit großen Ton, I mean, with huge sound, right? So for string players, how to get more sound? You have to use him a bow, right? So he's really, and look at this, triple forte in the first violin. So even though it's the same music that we heard before, the same tenutos are used to lengthen the phrases. This time it's much bigger. It's a big, much more present sound, right? So you have to save, as you play it the first time, well before this is like 56, then you have to make sure that the second time you have room to be much, much bigger, okay? Okay, so I'm out of time. And of course, I've only scratched the surface of the first movement, right? And there are so many things in the piece that it's such a wonderful piece that I'm so excited about being in person, talking about details and working on these with you in person starting next week. And so Brett, our librarian, has worked really hard to make the parts available. The scores are available. I've made the scores available. Let me just share that screen. Just give me one more minute. In our folder, if you look at not only are the parts, all the separate parts available to you, but we have the three movements. So here's the first movement, second movement, third movement. And that's the Klaus Simon reduction. Okay. If people are interested, I'll also upload the fourth movement, but we're not performing the fourth movement. And this one is the full 1911 full score version. So you can kind of check back and compare places. Okay. And then
we also have paper parts ready to go for our first rehearsal as well. So you'll have a nice stapled folded booklet with the music for you to have that you can keep.
Awesome. And Brett will bring that to the first rehearsal of the Mahler, which will be Tuesday.
Okay. Yep.
On Tuesday, it's really important that we have protocols that we're going to follow. We have two 30-minute slots in Klarman. If you face Klarman Hall, I'll try to find signs for it. And I don't know whether they've already put the signs up in that room because I haven't been to Klarman yet. We'll enter through one. The protocol for most classrooms is you have to enter through one door and exit through another door, just like when you're doing your surveillance testing, where you enter through one door and you exit through the different door. So we'll use that same protocol. Okay. I may need some help moving a set of stands for that first rehearsal. So if people are available, 3:30, I'm going to start moving all the stands that we need. Okay. All right. So once we move it, we have access to this, the closets in Klarman. I've been given a key so we can store the stands that we'll need in there so that we won't have to move every time. Okay. All right. Are there any questions before I let you go today?
Logistics. Wait, so is rehearsal taking place in the basement of Klarman or?
So in Klarman Hall, there's a auditorium. So that's where we are.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Yeah. Okay.
I actually have a question, if I may, for the score. I'm not really sure what this symbol means. Like, don't play the line or what? Like this X. Just don't play the line or don't play the notes or what does it mean? I don't know.
Okay, so we are using rental parts. So the rental parts have markings from the previous performance, those are not my markings. So I think some of the Boeings are helpful, but it doesn't mean we have to go by what they've done, right? So something like that where we don't know what it means, we don't have to do that, okay? There might be a good reason for somebody to have done that, but as of right now, let's play what's in the score.
So I should practice it as well.
Yes. It might be because there are certain solo parts divisions, right? So when the piece is done with more than one string part, player per part, then there's a division of solo versus tutti. So that might be one of those indications where you have a tutti part, and then it says, oh, that's just a solo, because there is a feature solo first violin and solo big second solo second violin part. We'll get there when we get there. Yeah. Okay. All right. So I will see you Tuesday.